world has a wide variety of curious cuisines everywhere you look. You may have come to a restaurant and seen a new food that you're not familiar with and decided to brave it anyway. Yet one of the most culturally taboo cuisines on just about any menu is the whole concept of consuming another human being. In ancient times, warriors would consume the flesh of their fallen enemy to absorb their power, or so they would say. And as culturally taboo as cannibalism may be, it's still happening even today. Welcome to NightDocs. Today, we're going to be talking about cannibalism restaurants. Can there really be such a thing as a cannibal restaurant? Well, today we're going to explore the possibility of that. This reported illegal establishment, and our story takes place in the city of Onitsha in the Nigerian state of Anambra. Nigeria is obviously pretty well known for being kind of a hotbed for lots of different shady stuff going on. There's warlords, there's even this video that I found where evidently somebody is being assaulted in the street after it was found that he was attempting to sell a pepper soup with actual human flesh as one of the ingredients. Take a look. All right, so it's difficult to make out a lot of the commotion here, but this man here has been kind of accused. And I've edited the most violent parts out of this here so that it's not too difficult to watch. But apparently this crowd is not happy with this person in the market selling what is described in the YouTube video as human remains in this pepper soup here. And we get a couple of shots of the bowl itself here. It's difficult to make out exactly what we're seeing in there, but it's pretty obvious that the crowd that's gathering is not happy with this particular vendor in this market in Nigeria. And at the end of this, he is done with the harassment and he decides to take his, I guess we'll say, product, and he slinks off. So in Nigeria, there's this article from The Independent, which is a British newspaper. And in this article, here's the headline: cannibal restaurant with roasted human heads on the menu shut down by police. Police arrested 11 people and closed a restaurant after two human heads wrapped in cellophane were discovered at a hotel restaurant that had been serving human flesh. A tip-off led police to a macabre discovery in Anambra, Nigeria, I hope I pronounced that right, with 11 people being arrested and AK-47 guns and other weapons being seized. Human flesh was apparently being sold as an expensive treat at the restaurant, with authorities saying that roasted human head was even on the menu. They got a quote here. I went to the hotel early this year after eating. I was told that a lump of meat was being sold at N700, the Nigerian currency, I guess. I was surprised, a pastor who had visited the eatery said. So I didn't know that it was human meat that I ate at such an expensive price. What is this country turning into? Can you imagine people selling human flesh as meat? He added. Seriously, I'm beginning to fear people in this part of the world. And this is where it gets a little spicy here. Another local added to the Osun Defender newspaper. I always noticed funny movements in and out of the hotel. Dirty people with dirty characters always came into the hotel. So I wasn't surprised when the police made this discovery in the early hours of yesterday. The tabloid reported that two army caps, 40 rounds of live ammunition, and so many cell phones were also discovered by authorities. So here we have a news article saying that this was an actual cannibalism restaurant found in Nigeria that was shut down by the local police that were there. Okay, so let's dig a little bit further, because there's not a lot of articles on this story, so what can we extract from it here? So, doing another search, we end up finding, of all things, a Snopes article on it. So let's check this out. So the claim that a restaurant in Nigeria was serving roasted human heads, turns out it's a mixture of true and false. There were human heads that were found there. It wasn't necessarily a cannibalism restaurant. What it looks like from this Snopes article here is that it was actually kind of a game of telephone where somebody told a little bit of a story online and people started talking about it and it got picked up. And unfortunately, the Independent didn't update their article when this information was uncovered, because it turns out that they weren't serving human flesh. But what's interesting is that a couple of human heads were found in a hotel room. It seems like it was a pretty hostile disagreement between the hotel owner and a local warlord, from what I'm picking up. And so the hostile party here left a couple of human heads in the hotel room as a message to the hotel owner. What's really important here is the Snopes article here actually pokes some weaknesses in the Independent article. It says the article was completely lacking in verifiable details. The name of the hotel where the gruesome discovery was allegedly made was withheld. It's true. The persons quoted in the article were referenced only by vague descriptions and not by name, like a vegetable seller, a pastor. Right. None of the 11 persons purportedly arrested was identified, and not a single law enforcement officer or other official was quoted, named, or referenced in the story. So this is where we start getting into kind of a modern day problem that I personally have a big issue with, where people tend to find something, it seems sensational, it seems crazy, and you just like it, you share it, you pass it along without doing just the smallest amount of verified research to just find out if what you're actually sharing or repeating is true or not. So this is a really important exercise in just verifying the truth of things that we find online. I need to pause a moment. At this exact moment, this video was done. I started this topic and this video months ago. I told everyone I had a fun little short video ready to go that was gonna be out soon. In fact, the human meat video was supposed to be a fun follow-up to watch that I was just gonna release right after this one. This was the first of numerous topics that I was tackling to make a new series of shorter videos to just try and get my upload frequency up. For once, I just wanted to tackle something interesting that wasn't going to take months to research. Just do something simple and rein in my tendency to overdo it. But something was bothering me. There had to be more. As I mentioned, this was originally planned as a short one-off video. There are rumors to be establishments like the one that I've described in several parts of the world. I was going to start off by talking about Nigeria, and then move on to Brazil and Los Angeles. Those sections that I did are pretty much done, edited, and just about ready to go, but the story that I uncovered from Nigeria, which is what we're going to talk about today, became such a giant story, I decided to focus on it solely and scrap the other parts altogether. They are pretty interesting, they just didn't warrant the kind of attention that this one deserved. If you'd still like to see those other parts that I filmed and edited and put together, happy to do it. Just let me know in the comments if you're interested in seeing it. And of course, please be sure to subscribe to NightDocs and turn the notifications on, since YouTube doesn't really seem to alert people when I release new content, unfortunately.
And it's a real shame, because although my upload frequency isn't quite as high as other channels, people who do come here know that I put everything that I have into these videos, trying to provide the most premium experience that I can manage to create for you, all for free. Which is why I'm so grateful for the sacrifice of those of you who have decided to become a closer part of all of this by supporting me on patreon.com/nightdocs. Your support means the world to me, and I want you to know that it truly helps me to survive. Since YouTube has become my full-time job now, whether I was ready for it or not, my ability to do what I truly love is completely at the mercy of the kindness of strangers. And I have a lot of gratitude in my heart for those of you who believe in this as much as I do to make this happen. Thank you so much. To get to the real story of what was really going on here, I got to give you a little bit of context. Now, I had to dig really hard to find the real story here because there aren't really any news articles on this. In fact, when I was digging, I found that the reporting on this was so incredibly negligent and incompetent that I was left just infuriated by the end of it. I mean, according to the BBC, their reporting on this states,
"Police then raided the restaurant, where they discovered fresh human heads that were still bleeding. The blood was in the process of being drained into a plastic bag."
Not only could I not find a single other publication mentioning that little detail there, what's equally egregious is that the BBC decided to publish this as fresh news a whole 2 years. 2 years after the events took place, and simply copied the rest of the reporting wholesale from Nigerian tabloids that had started the story, which was picked up by New York Daily News, the International Business Times, the Independent, the Metro, Gawker. Every single one of these articles were nearly identical without verifying a single detail, as far as I can tell. So to pick up where all these news outlets dropped the ball, I dug a little bit deeper. And there was a Snopes article that I started with that I had found that had an interview with the hotel owner, a man by the name of Bonaventure Mokwe. Didn't really seem to have too many credible sources, and I didn't seem to be able to verify any of the details of the story, so kept digging and digging. Well, I found the owner of the hotel on social media, started digging through his Facebook posts along with other Nigerian locals that were around the area. I reached out to him and his friends and his business partner several times, to both Mokwe and his business partner, but I never heard back, tried over and over again. Unfortunately, but digging through all of these reports, the details of the story remain pretty consistent, and they seem to be backed up by other accounts and details that I was finding. Here's what I think I know. So it turns out that the hotel in question, it's called Upper Class Hotel, which was located at number 8 Old Market Road in Onitsha, Anambra. Probably pronouncing that wrong. It's a state in Nigeria. But it was also previously owned by Bonaventure Mokwe's father, a local tribal chief who passed it on to his son, Bonaventure. Now, from what I gather, Mokwe was an astute businessman with several ambitious business ventures in the area, with the crown jewel of his business empire being his 3-story hotel in Onitsha. He had a lot of goodwill and friends in the community, as far as I can tell anyway, but he'd made some enemies in the area as well, one of which had evidently tried and failed to have him assassinated in 2009. So fast forward to 2013, Mr. Mokwe gets into what he describes as a motor park dispute with some Onitsha natives. That's what he says. There's not a whole lot of clarification on what that means. And that happened on July 31st, 2013. Really important, that date, because the very next day is when all hell breaks loose, August 1st, 2013. You'll want to remember that date, August 1st, 2013. Now, before I go further, just a bit of context on how the government operates there. They have a federal government which oversees the legislative, judicial, and executive branch, and they have a constitution, they have a Supreme Court, they've got all the bells and whistles that makes our government work. Where it differs, and I haven't looked too deeply to really understand this, but from what I understand, and what I've read, the city of Onitsha stands apart as it's kind of a semi-sovereign constitutional monarchy within the country of Nigeria. So under the jurisdiction of the state and the federal government, Onitsha has a king, and that king is called an Obi. The Obi at this time was a man by the name of Peter Obi. Keep that name in mind as well, Peter Obi, because that's going to be huge in this story. Peter Obi has been investigated in the past for possible embezzlement for millions of dollars. He later went on to become governor of the state of Anambra and even ran in 2019 under the vice presidential ticket of the Nigerian general election. Now, he didn't win, but reports I read tell me that this election, like several in the past that he was involved with, were rife with ballot box stealing, voter intimidation, voter buying, all sorts of shady stuff. In fact, Obi had been impeached back in 2007 for gross misconduct, but later used his influence to get that impeachment overturned, and he became governor of the state. Okay, so back to the story here. So leading up to this August 1st, 2013 date, which is so important, Makwe had been having several run-ins with these Onitsha natives who had been giving him a hard time, harassing him and his businesses. And Makwe makes an appeal to his local authorities to intervene, like, help me out here. And it goes ignored. He tries several more times and no one helps him out. And he ends up petitioning the Obi. He actually writes to him three times and he gets ignored every time. So Makwe goes to court, gets an injunction requiring the Obi to respond and to intervene. And his account of what happens next goes as follows.
I wrote the Obi of Onitsha three times, asking him to intervene and call the natives to order, but he remained understandably silent. When that failed, I wrote a petition to the Anambra State Commissioner of Police, which he minuted to the area commander, who in turn assigned an inspector to investigate. But these efforts ended as soon as they started.
Okay, so when he's ignored by the Obi and issued a court order to the Obi to get him to intervene, it didn't go over super well. In fact, on August 1st, a man by the name of John Obi checked into room 102 of upper class hotel, Mr. Makwe's hotel, and he planted two human skulls, some rusty old rifles and ammo, a bunch of old cell phones, and then he went and called the police. 7 a.m. that morning, Makwe is alerted to the commotion and he puts a meeting on hold that he had had that day to purchase some land, and he speeds over to the hotel. He's met by a police force of over 100 police officers who do about 5 minutes of investigating and haul him and his business partner, Dr. Justin Nwankwo, I hope I pronounced that right, who is his business partner. He's also the hotel manager. And so he hauls Dr. Nwankwo, Makwe, and about 13 other staff members off to prison. Justin and Makwe are held for 88 days in prison without a single charge and tortured the entire time that they're there. Now, what's really interesting to me is that Makwe and his staff were arrested immediately upon their arrival to the hotel. There was no connection that Makwe had anything to do with what was found in room 102. He really was just the owner of the hotel. But immediately upon his arrest, a local newspaper called the Osun Defender, which brags that it's the, quote, sixth most visited newspaper site in Nigeria, pretty hilarious to me, posted the article claiming cannibalism was taking place, which eventually got blasted all over the news networks a year after the events. So here's the thing. All of these articles cite Osun Defender as the source of the original article, but if you look at the bottom of it, it leads to a rumor on a gossip blog dated August 4th, 2013, 3 days after the events. And that blog post finally leads us to the actual origin of the cannibalism rumor that was posted earlier that day, August 4th, 2013, on a rumor forum called Nigel Loaded, something like that. and it was posted by a user called Duration. Now, I tried looking deeper to try and figure out who this Duration guy was. I guess I was kind of hoping that I'd find some kind of connection between him and the business rivals of Mr. Mockway, because that would certainly make this a tidy explanation. Unfortunately, the Wayback Machine didn't have any of the history of that username archived. I couldn't really look any deeper, so I kind of hit a dead end there. But anyway, this is the point where we kind of come full circle. So if you take the most recent news article that's out there on this, we've got the Metro article from May of 2015, which sources BBC Swahili from a few days prior, which, you know, credit where credit is due. They did retract the story as being false, but the story is still up on their YouTube channel, whatever. And every single step of the way, each publication copied and pasted almost verbatim the exact same story, some of which, like the BBC, they even made up a few extra details to throw in there, I guess to make it juicier or something, which is absolutely unbelievable, the level of malfeasance that's going on here in some otherwise classically known to be pretty credible and trustworthy news organizations, you know? But I'm still not done, because this thing still keeps going deeper and deeper. And it turns out that a representative of the local government showed up to the demolition of the hotel. I found multiple instances of people in Facebook groups, like these Nigerian Facebook groups. It was a lot of Google Translate I was doing. They were telling these firsthand accounts of seeing this particular woman, though she's never really named. And she was asked by a lot of people why she'd come to the demolition of the hotel, to which she replied that she had been invited as a spectator. Invited by whom? She wouldn't say. And when she was asked who had ordered the destruction of the hotel, she claimed that she didn't know, even though everyone at this point knew full well that Peter Obi had ordered the destruction of upper class hotel. But all of this was just rumor. There was no photographs, no videos, nothing, no real evidence. And this was evidently the talk of the whole town. So why was there nothing out there? This was driving me crazy. There was no evidence that any part of this story was true. No photos, nothing. The news organizations hadn't said anything about this after the original claims, and they obviously dropped the ball. But if a giant media conglomerate can't find the true story, what chance do I have? I don't know. But for some reason, I had this gut feeling there was something to all of this. And why was Mockway so convinced Peter Obi had something to do with it? There was no evidence that he had anything to do with it as far as I could tell. And none of the accounts said anything about him being around when Mockway was arrested. Not many people even knew the name of the hotel. Maybe that could turn up something.
Mr. Peter Gregory Obi, Honorary Special Advisor to the President on Finance and member of the country's economic management team, is the immediate past executive governor of Anambra State.
Chief Peter Obi may be indicted by the Economic and Financial Crimes Commission of Nigeria over possible crimes committed while serving during his 8-year tenure as the governor of Anambra State.
I will now be joined here in the Lagos studio by the vice presidential candidate of the People's Democratic Party in the 2019 election and the former governor of Anambra State. Mr. Peter Obi, thank you so much for coming here tonight.
You put money worth about 2 billion naira of the state money in a brewery.
I have no investment there, not 1 naira.
No.
If you see Peter Obi as owner of one share, one share, it doesn't exist. I invested another 10 over several billions in banks, including banks where I have share.
Took money belonging to Anambra State government and put it in a company in which your family has interest. That's what you're telling me.
The family company started by my own parents. When I became governor, I had nothing to do with NES.
Okay, so how much today has your family made from the investment?
I was investing for the future of the state.
Virginia Etiaba has been sworn in as Nigeria's first female governor after Anambra State Legislature impeached Peter Obi for gross misconduct. Mr. Obi said he would not leave office and has criticized the whole process as unconstitutional. The BBC correspondent says the battle could get more volatile if supporters of the two sides take to the streets.
Public office holders must be accountable to the people. Governance is about service to the people, and that cannot be achieved without accountability.
Was there more? I went back and looked at the other search results for upper class hotel in Nigeria this time, and then dated August 4th, 2013. Shot in 144p on a cell phone. God. That is exactly what it looks like. Including the rusty old firearms, the cell phones. It was all true. Why was I so obsessed with this? Was this even an interesting story? Was there any end to it? I had spent so long looking into this, with nothing to show for it. Now, I don't know what to do.
What am I doing?
Well, I reached out to Peter Obi several times for comment. He didn't respond. I sent emails, tweets, Facebook messages, pretty much every way that I could think of to try and get in contact with him. Unfortunately, the 2019 vice presidential candidate of Nigeria has better things to do than talk to somebody like me. Mr. Mokwe made a Facebook post in April of 2019, celebrating the death of one of the men that he claims is responsible for setting him up, placing the skulls in room 102 of Upper Class Hotel, even posting the photo of the man lying in the middle of the street in Onitsha. So the end of this story, or at least where it stands today, is Mr. Mokwe and his business partner, Dr. Justin Nwankwo, are suing the government for reparations for the loss of Mr. Mokwe's hotel when he was released from prison after 88 days. And when he was released from prison, he was not only threatened, he was told, you know, look, the Nigerian elections are coming up. If you're gonna make us look bad, it's gonna end badly for you. But now if you wait, we'll make you a deal. If you stay quiet until after the elections and then talk to us and we'll keep this quiet, we'll make it right by you. So Mr. Mokwe waited and he waited and he waited and then nothing. So now he's on a crusade to get back what was stolen from him, to repay the gangster corrupt politicians and the police force that framed him, destroyed his business, imprisoned him, tortured him for 3 months, only to emerge from prison and his captors to find that it was a brand new world where he had lost everything. Knowing that they only released him because they couldn't find a way to legally justify keeping someone in custody any longer than they had without any kind of formal charge of any kind. So, if you're watching, Mr. Mokwe, I wish you the best of luck on this journey. And I hope they make a movie someday.
And just when I didn't think that this rabbit hole, this absolutely insane rabbit hole, couldn't get any deeper. We all like a story that's easy to follow, where there are clear protagonists and villains. Something about Mr. Mokwe's Facebook posts that I'd been reading, but hadn't really stuck out to me until I was almost done with this. He often signs off on his posts, referring to himself as the chief priest. The chief priest of what, though? I had assumed it was some kind of benign tribal designation. It didn't really strike me as anything interesting or worth looking into at first. At the end of my conversations with the Reddit user that helped me gain a little understanding of the culture in Onitsha, and also helped translate what the crowd was saying at the destruction of Upper Class Hotel, I asked him offhand what Mokwe meant when calling himself the chief priest. He started telling me about the culture of the area rooted in pagan worship, and when I told him the details about skulls, he became quite alarmed, and even having ties to Onitsha, he had never heard the story that I told him about Mokwe and Peter Obi. He told me to look into a relatively unknown concept with details very similar to what I had uncovered. Okija. Well, it turns out, the Igbo people, before European expansionism brought Christianity to the area, practiced a type of pagan religion that the Europeans tried hard to snuff out because of practices that didn't line up with European worldviews. Specifically because of elements that they thought were against God's will, especially things like idol worship and human sacrifice. Almost all adherents to this religion are gone today. But recently, pockets of people in the region have been popping up, practicing the old ways. I found story after story from the region. News reports about police breaking up violent underground pagan shrines adorned with human skulls, weapons, blood rituals. A few years back, a shrine was discovered in the forest near Onitsha, lined with human remains. Dozens. It's apparently a very secretive group in Onitsha led by a chief priest. Locals, prominent businessmen, even powerful politicians periodically visit these shrines to swear oaths to each other before their pagan gods. And when an oath is broken, the penalties for that can range from magical curses and hexes to things much worse. Who are you, Bonaventure Mokwe?
Why won't you talk to me?
What is the real relationship you seem to have with Peter Obi? What exactly are you the chief priest of?
Some kind of way we make it. The intro of his vid.
If exposing and holding bad actors around the world who see children as prey qualifies as cyberbullying, then sign me the fuck up. Let's go to war.
He sure could have used that voice thing that Money Max uses, because it was a total failure. Let's go to war. Dude, chill out, Rambo. It appears that old man Rambo has now asked his followers to spam the cyber tip hotline to report that we are a pedophile ring. When will these people learn that the safety measures on this website are in place? They're outlined everywhere. It's very clear they are. I mean, anyone can go onto any internet platform and type a disgusting sentence or request disgusting things. Those are some slanderous accusations that you're making there, Rambo.
You seem awfully defensive for someone claiming to make a safe environment where children can talk to strangers online unsupervised. You may think that just because we've been quiet, we've moved on and lost interest. Well, I hate to disappoint you.
Drop them into it.